today, Bill is going to share with us a very, very special project that's dear to his heart called Going Home. So please join me in welcoming Bill Frakes.
I am going to show a lot of pieces that we've been working on. And we means me and my production team. I'll say we a lot because Laura and the others all do a lot of work on this. It's not just me. And I am going home in a number of different ways. Physically, going home back to Nebraska. It's the 150th anniversary of Nebraska statehood in another year. So I've been building a pretty extensive website and collection of work out there to salute that. So we'll finish this next 6 months whenever we can, and then we're going to spend a lot of time out there next year. I'll probably spend most of the year either in Nebraska or Brazil. They have some games down there that I have to go to. And Larry's right, I left the staff of Sports Illustrated. Well, actually, they don't have a staff anymore, so it was hard to stay on it since they decided to end it. But it's been a lot of fun. I have done some work for the Associated Press. I went with President Obama and President Bush to Selma for that. That was a really interesting assignment. I'm doing some work for them. Last week, I spent most of the week working for ESPN. And it's just been an interesting year. So far this year, I've been on the road about 450,000 miles, and we're not even halfway through June, I guess. So lots of fun, lots of things going on. So the going home, I flew in from Nebraska yesterday. I'm flying back there tonight. A lot of going home that way, and also going back to my roots as a photojournalist. I started in photojournalism, and I'm going back to photojournalism and documentary work and getting away from the pure sports so much. So last year I showed you a little snippet from the start of a piece we were doing called Nebraska Skies. And Nebraska is an interesting place. It's a place of cowboys and poets, buffalo and meadowlarks. It's a tapestry of land that's harnessed to be bountiful. It's a place that helps feed the world in a number of different ways. You have to earn your fun in Nebraska. Mother Nature makes you work pretty hard at that. There's huge temperature swings, huge differences in topography, and it's a wind that's unrelenting. But Mother Nature gave Nebraska back some beautiful scenery, more miles of river than any other state, believe it or not, and vistas that stretch on forever. The interesting thing for me is Nebraska really gets slammed a lot for being it's disparaged. And I think it's one of America's great treasures. Sorry if I keep looking down, these lights are just really bright. Everybody calls it a flyover state. If they just take their time and thank you and get off the interstate a little bit, you could find a pretty interesting place. But this isn't, it's an American oasis. It's filled with kind, generous people that are courteous and safe. It's the only state that's never had a deficit. I think in the last 100 years, they've never been over 3% unemployment statewide. So it is the spacious skies and those bountiful fields of grain, but it's a lot more than that. And Nebraska's never really gotten a break PR-wise, so that's part of the reason I'm doing it, because I'm proud of it. You know, when Custer was at the Battle of Little Bighorn, he pulled all his, you know, and the defeat was imminent, he pulled all his troops in, he said, listen, guys, got bad news, we're just about to get eliminated here, but the good news is we don't have to go back through Nebraska. So, you know, it's always been that way. So this is Nebraska skies. This is home for me. And when you're watching it, you're going to see some electrical storms and things like that. And when I was in Beirut, I remembered, I've been in Beirut six times this year working on a piece with, it's an education piece with a group of kids that are learning in conflict and doing a really good job. And I'd hope to have that ready to show now, but we were shooting 2 weeks ago and we're not done. But maybe next year, if Larry gives me a chance, I'll show it again. Or I'll show it for the first time. But anyway, I was in Beirut and it made me think of when I was getting ready for this presentation, I was looking at these some of these slides and I was thinking a lot about my mom because she's had as Larry mentioned, a huge influence on my career and my life. And so, you know, she used to keep me very close to home, and you know, she's pretty much she was a grade school. She taught for over 60 years, and she was a principal and a teacher, and so a lot of strict rules and about, you know, what I did and behavior and things. So first, when you look at this film and you see me hanging around all the lightning bolts, that wasn't sanctioned behavior. And second, going back to Nebraska, when I was in Beirut, I was, Laura and I were working in an area where the first time I was in Beirut was 1982 when they were having a conflict there. And there was a lot of bombings and things like that. And CNN had just become a thing then. They hadn't, before there hadn't been really 24-hour cable news. And I was working for Time, and my mom, my editor in London got a call from my mom. And I hadn't realized that CNN had been filming that day. They'd been up on top of a hotel shooting a street scene, and I'd gotten trapped between two factions that were shooting each other, and I was hiding a lot, but I was right in the middle of it. It wasn't a really good place to be. And so my mom called my editor, who was working at Times London Bureau, and said, "Has Bill called in today?" And she said, "No, he hasn't. Is there something that you need me to tell him?" Mrs. Frakes, she said, "Yeah, just tell him that I saw him on that CNN thing and he's grounded." So there you go. So this is the Nebraska skies. Thank you. Thanks. Is that what y'all thought Nebraska looked like? It's a little different. Yeah, anytime you want to go for a photo walk out there, you just need to let me know. We can make that happen. Larry's been. You know, the whole paradigm of how the media works has changed. I've spent most of my life working for big media. I mean, it's not a lot, not much bigger than Time, Sports Illustrated, and CNN worldwide. I've done a lot of assignments for big groups, but that's changing for me, and it's changing in the industry. A lot of the media that we're doing is all self-financed, self-funded, and you can do different kinds of things. You cut through a lot of the artificial barriers to getting things published, and where you used to have to have a printing press or a television network. Now, if you've got web access and some smart people and some people understand social media, my friend Sam, who coaches me about this a lot, you know, you can make a pretty big difference, and you can get things out. And one of the things that I want to do, I grew up in a really small town. My hometown, the place where I was born, was 91 people. And I spent a lot of my early days, you know, dealing with cattle and football. So I wanted to do a piece on six-man football in the state of Nebraska, because it's I think Texas and Nebraska are really the only, maybe Utah, that place where they really play very much of that. And it's a whole different kind of game, and a different feeling, and a different way of doing things. And so I didn't want to have somebody just sit and read a script or talk about it the way we normally would. I wanted to do something that just had a little bit more of a feel. So there was a young lady named Rachel Price, and she's was 21 years old. She was a junior in college, and some friends of mine that live in O'Neill, Nebraska, it's a small town of about 2,000, Katie and Kevin Morrow, some of you know them, I'm sure. I asked them, I said, hey, you know, I need somebody that's young and fresh that understands football, understands music, and kind of like to get them to do a soundtrack for me. So Katie said, well, I had this girl when she was in second grade that she could sing pretty well. She's a pretty clever writer and really love to put you in contact with her. So I said, all right. So we went up to O'Neill, and sure enough, Rachel shows up, and she'd been working all day long cutting the grass in the public parks in O'Neill, Nebraska, so she's covered with grime and dirt and grass. But after talking to her for 3 minutes and listening to her sing, I decided that she'd be perfect for this. So she had some music she wanted to share, and I told her we needed to make some changes, but it was pretty much spot on. It was wonderful. So Rachel came out the very next night. She cleans up pretty well, and turns out, fortunately, and we shot a short video of her singing one of her songs. It's called In a Little Nebraska Town, and I'm going to show you that. We used the football visuals that we already had been working on, along with the music video of we shot with Rachel, and the first week it was online, it got 7 million views, which is not bad for little production like that. It's well over that now. So, and when the day started, she didn't have an agent, she didn't have a music contract, she didn't have anything. At the end of the week, she had all those, and she's been touring ever since. And she's got her new CDs out soon. Probably as quick as I can finish that last video. All right. So this is In a Little Nebraska Town.
Town girl, everyone spoke on a first name basis. Friday night was the main event under those bright lights with high hopes of a win. But we knew it didn't matter anyway. If there's a victory, it's gonna be a sight to see. A bonfire made of cottonwood trees. And even if we lose, we knew the game was skewed. Of all the moments that brought me here, and all the memories that I feel, I'm pretty sure the best ones that I found started in a little Nebraska town. See you back Saturday, gather on the TV, put our lives on pause, and there really is no place like here. Living that good life, wouldn't wanna change a thing. Born red,
It's war time.
Let's hate ourselves.
It's war time.
Let's hate ourselves.
It's war time.
Of all the moments that brought me here, and all the memories that I feel, I'm pretty sure the best ones that I found started in a little Nebraska town. Hey, yeah, yeah. In that little Nebraska town.
So I guess a lot of this stuff that I'm showing you is all pretty simple. You know, it's not a big production budget. It's not huge truckload of stuff. Not the way, you know, if I go to the Olympics, we'll have a huge team. Or I was just at the Triple Crown at the Belmont Stakes, and hundreds of cameras and lots of things going on. These are just very simple, easy to do presentations that everybody can do. You know, they just have some, you know. You make pictures with your heart, your eye, your mind, your soul. The equipment's really not the key. Just if you can use the equipment you have well, then you can do it. And it's all about recognizing stories and seeing things that matter. Well, we were out driving last summer, and we drove past a small church, and it looked kind of cool. So I said, well, let's just stop and go in. And so being Nebraska, you can do that. You can just walk into a church in the middle of the day, and nobody gets upset about it. Or any kind of a building, actually. So there was a man in there practicing the piano, and so I talked to him for a couple minutes, and Laura was doing something else, and I went out and I got her and said, hey, we need to just be a little bit late to this next shoot. Call him and tell him we're going to be late, so we're going to spend an hour or two with these people. So now this presentation is, people have seen this, at last count, 9 million times, been downloaded from the Nebraska site. So this is just a couple we met in Nebraska, but I thought they had something to say about life and commitment.
We first met because his sister and my sister lived together in Lincoln. We didn't date, and then we went to camp.
And then I asked her for a date, and then she just laughed.
You know how you do sometimes. You don't know if they're serious about it or not.
That's where it started. And the next year was better.
So the next year we got there and we started dating in the first part of the week after the services. We'd go in for sodas or something in town, and all of a sudden, I don't know that we did too much help getting any games started for anybody else on board. And so, 51, he gave me a ring for Christmas, and we were married the following June.
It's great having her as a partner, yes.
Oh, I wouldn't want it any other way. I think, you know, it's wonderful to have that many years together.
Our marriage, I think, is just, it's just great, outstanding, really.
You know, it's just kind of fun just to be able to find something and share it with everybody. You know, it's one advantage of how the modern technology works. You know, my blog gets read by a couple hundred thousand people a month, and you know, even if I don't have anything to say, they read it, apparently. But you know, there's just a lot of different things you can do, and you can do them quickly and share. And I guess that's really what I'm trying to say today. You don't have to go someplace exotic or travel the world to find good stories or something. You just have to have your eyes and ears open and have a commitment to telling stories. Similar situation here. I wanted to go to a branding So I looked around, and there's a lot of families in Nebraska going back to the ranch. And there's a, how many people know where Lakeside, Nebraska is? I was going to be impressed. It's a town of 11, which makes my hometown of Angora at 91 look huge. But I found this couple and their kids, and I just want to spend a few minutes and let you see what their life is like. It's just a very different way of living, I think.
Whenever I return home, the Sandhills are like an old friend that are opening their arms and welcoming me back.
We get to be out here in the middle of nowhere and see this gorgeous view every single morning. And really, I am living the American dream in terms of having the capability of seeing my family grow, being able to be where I want to be, have a job but not make it feel like a job.
I feel like a very lucky guy. I have a great wife and three wonderful kids that I couldn't ask for more. For me, deciding to be a rancher, I've always had a love for animals, like I did 4-H as a kid, and meeting Megan actually just made it a lot easier decision.
Living on a ranch in Nebraska is very gratifying. I mean, you see your hard work come through. You know, we raise cattle and we put up hay, and everything has a purpose. And we're raising a product that people eat, a safe product, a healthy product people eat. And
I think you have to be pretty driven and motivated to live out here, because you do need to have that level of self-sufficiency. You have to have that level of want to try new things, whether it looks pretty or not. You just go and you do it. And the self-sufficiency part of it that you actually need in terms of providing for your family is probably a more driving thing. I mean, we raise all of our own beef. My wife's gonna go out and finish planting the garden today. We've already got one garden patch planted. It's always that good feeling that you get whenever you can go out and pick an apple off the tree and be like, yeah, it's good to eat. Let's go ahead and eat it. Or, you know, the steak that comes on your plate, you're kind of like, I know how this steak was raised. I could probably tell you what calf it came from. I probably spent the night up waiting for that cow to calve. And it's fun. It's fun to see what you can try to do for yourself and do for others too. Because, I mean, that's part of the deal out here is if somebody needs help, you just go help them. That's what it is. And that's part of the self-sufficiency of the community as well. So,
you know, we move everything horseback, and you just get to be out there. And my father-in-law says it's probably about the most cost-effective thing we could do on the ranch, because when you're setting a saddle, you're not spending any money. So just being on horses actually teaches you a lot about life. I mean, you got to be patient. You got to be willing to learn things that they do, and they're going to learn things you do. And it's really nice to do that.
You're working with something else. It may not be a human being, but I mean, you're working with an animal, and you know, they're putting their effort in to get the job done just as much as you are. And as anyone who ever's been on horseback and moved cows, is nothing greater is when your horse starts to really watch cows and really work with you. There's really not much more fun thing to do, really.
It's just a blessing that we get to do that. And I could do that with Megan, and I could take Ava and June out with us, and Paige, and
the girls can, you know, they can go with Ty if they want to, and they can be a part of it at a very early age, and they learn a lot. They learn to respect the land, they learn to respect for animals, and the kids out here just learn great values.
Living on a ranch out here in Nebraska is one of those things that you really can't count how many good things there are that are just unspoken and unknown until you actually are taking part in them. Your family is probably first and foremost the thing that you really, really start to understand. I don't have to go to work from 9 to 5 and be away from them, send my kids to daycare. The family unit is something that grows with you just as well as the cattle, just as well as the grass, just as well as anything else. It really, really grows with you. And as you get older, it even gets more and more noticeable. You know, Ava's 5, and it just seems like not too long ago she was just born. Or, you know, same thing with June. June's 3, and I can't picture June being 3 I just can't. But in Nebraska, on a ranch out here in the Sand Hills, you can actually see everything happen. You can see the kids grow, you can be with them, you can help them learn, you can help them experience different things that you can't anyplace else.
You know, it's just the Sand Hills. I mean, I've always called it home, and I hope I always will. I can't imagine myself living any other place.
I think I have the best life of everyone in the entire world.
Thanks. So, you know, we're just getting a chance to expose people to a way of life and a part of America that's just not as often seen anymore as I think it should be, maybe. And it's interesting, too, the resources you find in a state like Nebraska that I wouldn't have expected to find. One of the pieces I'm going out to work on this week was a gift from somebody I met a couple years ago when we started working on this. Sitting in my house in January, and I got a brown, you know, paper-wrapped book. And I open it up, and it's got a note on it. It's just, you know, scratching on the cover, you know, Bill Frakes, and, you know, on the paper. And I open it up, and there's a note, and it says, "This is a poet. I think you'll like his work. He's kind of new. He's a tree surgeon. But he just finished his PhD in poetry, and I think he's got a good work ethic, and I like the way he writes, and I think you will, so I think you should meet him." And it was signed Ted Kooser, who some of you may, I'm about to show you a piece on Ted. Ted's the Poet Laureate of the United States. So it's kind of fun when you get a package from the Poet Laureate saying, "Hey, check out our neighbor, this guy could write." So, I don't know. Anyway, so this is Ted.
I started writing, you know, having fun writing when I was just a little kid in elementary school, and then got really serious about it when I was probably 18 or 19, and have done it ever since. And I, you know, I've told students that the reason I'm pretty good at this is because I've really been doing it every day for 50 years. I talked to a guy at a lumberyard a number of years ago about horseshoe pitching, and he said that his Uncle Ed had been a tri-state champion horseshoe pitcher. And he said one day, he said to his uncle, he said, "Ed," he said, "how did you get so good at horseshoes?" And Ed said, "Son, you got to pitch 100 shoes a day." I get up around 4:30 and I try to write till 7, and I just sit with my notebook and kind of doodle in it, make a little journal entry, maybe do a little drawing, and maybe once or twice a month something comes up that is worth my time. The rest of the time I'm failing at being a writer, and when the writing's not going very well, I can always go out and do a little drawing or paint something and so on. It's being constantly engaged with trying to do something like that. You know, I'm not happy if I'm not writing or painting or making something. You know, life is too short, and when you get to be 71 years old, it really is too short. So I don't want to waste any time. One of the most marvelous things that happened to me as a writer was a number of years ago I wrote a poem about field mice moving their nests out of the field into the fence row when the plows are coming around. And it was a sort of a little Walt Disney animated film with these little mice with their lanterns and the old mice wailing and being upset by this thing and so on. And anyway, I published this poem somewhere. And shortly after that, a woman wrote to me and said, "I will never drive by a plowed field in the spring again without thinking of those mice." And I thought, this is my job. This is what I'm going to do.
when I grow up, I want to be Ted. I mean, it's pretty, I think it's pretty fabulous that, you know, he wanted to be a writer his whole life, and he was, I guess, self-published 11 books of poetry now and a book of drawings. And he had to make a living, so he sold insurance during the day and wrote every morning. I don't know, his early 60s, 63, 64, something like that. He won a Pulitzer Prize, which was a nice thing. And then he became poet laureate, which is another nice thing. And he just added, I called him a week ago, and he was writing. So, you know, going to go see him hopefully over the weekend. It's been an interesting journey. You know, I've had a lot of fun. I've been doing it for 36 years now. And I've gotten, as Larry said, to travel to a lot of different places, see a lot of different things. But what I find is that the simple things are what make the best pictures almost every single time. And sometimes it's just important to just slow down, walk slowly, think slowly, and try to process everything, and then put it all into some sort of perspective, some sort of order, and pay attention to the light, pay attention to the idiom of the language, the visual language I'm trying to use, and try to get it just exactly right. And that's not easy. I mean, I guess in my career, I've probably made about 10 million pictures, more or less. And if you take away the ones that are just a friend or we're goofing around or family, they're probably, I mean, I've had some good success, but I guess that they're probably about 6 or 7 that I think I got right. All the rest of them I'd like to have another crack at. If I could just go back and do it one more time, I think I could do it a little bit better. So that said, last summer there was an interesting development. You know, the Russia was acting like they were going to cause problems in that part of Europe again. And the Estonians and the Lithuanians, 25 years ago, managed to get their freedom from what was then the Soviet Union. And the Estonians did it by singing. And the Lithuanians did it through a little bit more serious revolt, or a little bit stronger physical revolt. And a lot of people died and got sent to the gulags and, you know, so on. So the Estonians now every 5 years have a festival and they celebrate what they did. So I took a group of 4 people with us and we went to Estonia and we did a piece on this. And the piece worked well, I think. I'll let you judge it, but we did it in about 48 hours, more or less. And I'm gonna show you 2 different iterations of it. One's just the film and then one's the long form piece that we did. The long form piece had in the 8 months from the time it was initially published, until 8 months later, had over 63 million looks. That's a lot. And so this is Estonia.
It was 1869. We gathered in the city of Tartu for our first song festival. And ever since, the song festival has been a beautiful way to express, please, dear Lord. Help us to keep our country and our language.
Celebration tradition is something what is in our history, and I think it is like in people's genealogy. And when we had singing revolution, Estonians, they just gathered to song celebration ground and sang. It was that declaration. And I remember the feeling that we have 80,000 people here. You can't arrest and you can't kill all of them. And I think that it made Estonian people feel that music can make difference. And that's why we continue with this tradition.
in Estonia, we love to say that we sang us free. In the way, it's truth in it because of the song celebration tradition. We survived as a nation through those Soviet years. That made us to believe that, yes, we are still here, we still speak in Estonia, we still sing in Estonia, and even we have new composers who are making wonderful and uncensored music of love to country, love to each other.
I've lived my whole life in a free country. I really can't imagine what it's like to be in, for example, Soviet Russia, which was the previous reign here. But I appreciate the fact that we're a free nation, and I think that freedom is very fragile. We should cherish this, and we cherish our freedom and our culture with the song and dance festival.
We're singing ourselves free, showing what we are.
So one, I learned a couple things when we did this. One was that the long-form journalism that you hear people talking about actually works. This is a page that we built. You can go to Straw Hat Visuals, and you can go to long-form, and you can find if you want. But in 4 days, 2 days, oops, I guess I'm going to print that. You can see we wrote about it. We did time-lapse. We just we did a lot of different things that were interesting, and we put it up, and the world responded. I mean, that's a lot of looks. Now, the second thing, and I'll get back to that in a second. The second thing that was fun, and again, some of my friends that I know that are in the front rows that fly a lot will appreciate this. So we rolled into Estonia, and we had 14 bags when we left. When we got there, we only had 3 bags. So I was a little bit annoyed because I had to start shooting in 2 days. So we were out covering, you know, setting up for some things, and Estonian national television showed up. And they said, well, now, you've been here a few times, and we know that, you know, that you're spending a lot of effort and stuff to show this to the world. And Estonia is not that big of a country. And they said, we really appreciate it. And I said, well, I think that the world needs to see this with Russia making noises again and your response to this, where you managed to get your freedom by just refusing to do anything but sing for 10 days. It's kind of a cool response. I like that. And I like the food here. The people are wonderful. Everything's good. And they said, well, you have a pretty glowing report on our country. Is there anything you don't like? I said, well, actually, Estonia Air sucks. They lost 11 of my 14 bags. And the guy laughed and said, well, that night on the nightly news, that was the lead comment. Estonia Air sucks. So the next day, we had a meeting with the president of the country, who you can see here. And I walk in, and he was educated at Princeton, so he's got perfect English, and he's a great guy. He walks up, and he sticks his hand out, and he says, have they found your bags yet? So my bags were found in 3 hours. It was pretty fun. Anyway, that's just an aside for our frequent traveler friends. But if you go through here and look at this, you can see we managed to accumulate a lot of information. We kind of took the vacuum sweeper approach to it. We sucked up everything we could find. We put it back, we repurposed it different ways, and, you know, there are photo galleries, there's stories that were written. A really interesting piece that Joya Bright wrote for us. She was actually in Lithuania when it happened, and she's now a photojournalist. This is Joey. She's got a really interesting writing style. If you don't read anything else in the piece, I would read it. I mean, you know, from the East they come, to the East they will be returning. It's just it's her seventh language that she's writing in. It's pretty amazing. But The other thing that I thought was really fun in the story, again, it's another piece I think if you have time to read it, it's really fun, is this woman, Christina Ain. And she wrote the lyrics to that song that you're reading. And she's one of their most widely published poets. And so this is Christine. On the day that 1/10 of her nation got together at a festival to celebrate basically the song that she wrote and the work that she did, this is at 2 in the morning. We had been trying to get together to schedule an interview, and it wasn't working. And I had to leave, and we had to hit some of the various networks that we were putting this up on, deadlines. So she came and found me and said, "Look, when this is over, I'll have time." And I said, "Really? It's 100 degrees outside, and 120,000 people are here to hear you talk and to work in this course and stuff." She said, "Yeah, it's important. I'll do it." So this is her at 2 a.m. after an 18-hour day. And the thing that I really enjoyed about her the most of all, not just her writing, not how gracious and friendly she was and how engaging she was, that I appreciate above everything else work ethic, I guess. And 3 years before, she didn't think she was getting her writing quite right. So she exiled herself to an island in the Baltic and practiced writing for a year, raised all her own food, and just wrote for a year to get it right. I thought that was kind of neat. So anyway, you can find it there. Let's see if I can figure the rest of this out. So I'm going to segue yet another quick one because I have Don and Larry in the front. So last year we went to Iceland together, a group of us. And we were out at this little town, it's not even a town really, it's just really a hotel. And it's called Badur, which, of course, in Iceland, if you have a hotel that's big enough to get on the map, because nobody actually lives in Iceland, it's just gorgeous scenery. So we were working on a time-lapse project, and I was trying to show some people how to do time-lapse, and everybody was talking. There were 12 of us, I guess, that went. And Don comes walking up, and we're at this little church, and he said, "I found some people that are kind of fun." I said, "Okay, good." And he said, I saw this woman in the hotel, and she had a dress on, and it was kind of interesting. And I said, "Oh, the one with the Leica." Which, of course, he noticed the dress, I noticed the Leica. We're not going to talk about anything more than that. And so they were going to get married. So they came up, and they were by themselves. They had one person with them, and they said, "We're going to get married. Would you guys like to join us or take a picture?" So you got all these people that are covered with cameras. We said, "Yeah, we can do that." So we made this little short wedding video for them. It's 2 minutes, and it's just one of those things that you stumble into. But I think it's really fun, and it just speaks to communicating. And this thing's been published a few different places. And again, we'll just let you see what you think of it.
Let's pray. O Lord God, Heavenly Father, you have created man and woman. You have destined them for marriage and have given them your command and blessing for this. We pray you to preserve and bless this couple so that everything that you allow to befall them will be for their good and to the praise and glory of your holy name. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one true God through all the ages. Let us now all pray the Lord's Prayer in our own native tongue and say together, Father, what? Closer at the kingdom. Helgist þitt nafn, tilkomi þitt ríki, verði þitt vilji svo á jörðu sem á himnum. Gef oss í dag og daglegt brauð og fyrirgef oss vorar skuldir, svo sem við erum fyrirgefum vorum skuldurum. Ei leið oss í freistinn, heldur frelsa oss frá illu, því að þitt ríki, mátturinn og dýrðinn að eilífu. Amen. Congratulations to both of you. You are no longer now kiss each other for the first time as husband and wife. Congratulations.
Appreciate it. This is how to find me. If you write me an email and put NMC in the subject header, I promise I'll write you back. So that's it. Thank you very much.